We'll first begin with mutual inductance, and to get an idea of what is mutual inductance, let's look at this pair of circuits over here. We have a coil which has say N1 turns and a current flows in this coil. We'll call this coil 1 and this is a part of circuit A. Now we have another coil which is placed over here. This is placed around the first coil and this is a part of another circuit and this is a part of circuit B, and let's say this coil is 2. Now if a current is flowing in the first coil, you know that there is a magnetic field. The magnetic field lines will look like this. Now you can see that this magnetic field, which is due to current in coil 1, also passes through coil 2. So the magnetic field is also present in coil 2. And this field is present due to current in coil 1. Now let's say the current in coil 1 changes. So if I1 changes, then the magnetic field through the coil 2, the magnetic field through coil 2 changes. And if the magnetic field changes, then the flux which is linked with coil 2 will also change, and you know that a changing flux produces an induced EMF. This is Faraday's law. So as a result of this changing flux in 2, we will get an induced EMF in 2, and the cause of this induced EMF is the changing current in 1. This phenomenon of inducing an EMF in one circuit by changing a current in another is called mutual induction. And the pair of circuits are said to show mutual inductance. Now we'll come to a more formal definition, the kinds which you need to write in your exams. But this was just to give you an idea that what is mutual induction. Now mutual inductance is defined as phi B over I A, which means flux in B circuit due to current in A circuit, or we can say phi A over I B. Both of these define M, the mutual inductance, and you will see that they have the same values. Whether we take current in 1 and flux in 2, or we take current in 2 and flux in 1, the value comes out to be the same. I guess that is why it is called mutual. Now we are going to find the value of the mutual inductance for this arrangement of coils. These are the same two solenoids. If you just recall, a solenoid consists of a helical winding and it usually has a circular cross section. Now coming back to this arrangement over here, the inner coil has N1 turns and the radius is R1. The area of cross section of this inner coil, which would be pi R1 square, will be denoted by A. So this is the area of cross section of the inner coil, and the outer coil has a radius of R2. It has a larger radius. So the radius and the number of turns in the outer coil is N2. Now both the coils have the same length L. Now let us find the mutual inductance for this case. And you know from the definition of mutual inductance that we have to take a ratio of the flux through 2 for the current in 1. Now when a current flows in coil 1, there is a magnetic field inside this coil, and that magnetic field is given by mu naught times Ni. In this case, we would denote this by N1 and the current is I1. And over here, N1 is the number of turns per unit length. So which in our case would be N1 over L, because the length of the solenoid is L. This value mu naught over here is a constant, and it has a value of 4 pi into 10 to the power minus 7 Henry per meter. This tiny constant, because it has a very small value, depends on the medium inside the core of the solenoid, which means instead of air, suppose this solenoid is wound on a piece of iron. See, the solenoid is wound on a piece of iron. In that case, you have to use the permeability of iron. And you know that the relative permeability of iron is 1000 times that of air. So in that case, to find the magnetic field, you would replace this with 1000 times mu naught times N1 times I1. This is just to give you an idea of this constant which we are using over here. Now you might be wondering, what is this unit that we've used, Henry? We'll just define this unit a short while later. Coming back to this expression, the magnetic field inside this solenoid is given by mu naught N1 I1, and over here we are assuming this is a very long and tightly wound solenoid, because in the center of the solenoid, towards the middle of the solenoid, this is the value for the magnetic field. And as you go towards the ends of the solenoid, the magnetic field becomes weaker and it actually becomes half. But over here we are assuming that the magnetic field in the entire region is mu naught N1 I1. Now we are going to find phi 2, the flux through 2. See, here I have drawn a single coil. This is the inner coil and the magnetic field is in this region. This is the outer coil which is wound around it. And we have to find the flux through this outer coil, through the red coil. Now, the flux, you know, is given by integral B dot dA, where A is the area of the coil. In this case, the field is perpendicular to the plane of the coil. So, the direction of the area vector and the direction of the magnetic field is the same. So, the flux would be B times the area A. But you can see that for the outer red coil, the field is only present in this area. So you only have to take this area, which is the inner area A. So the flux would be B1 times the area A, which is mu naught N1 I1 times A. Now this flux is through a single coil. So the total flux through all the coils, which is N2 turns, would be N2 times this value which we have over here for a single coil, which is N2 times mu naught N1 I1 A. So finally we have phi 2, the flux to the outer coil, and we can find the mutual inductance, because that is going to be a ratio of the flux through 2 to the current through 1, and this works out to be N2 mu naught N1 times A, and we can write this as, we'll just rearrange this a little. So we have mu naught times N2, N1 is N1 over L times A. So this is the value of mutual inductance 2, 1, just to denote that the current is through 1 and the flux is through 2. Now what we are going to do is, we are going to take a current through 2 and find the flux through 1, and similarly find the mutual inductance once again. You can see that when a current flows through coil 2, which is the red coil, there is a uniform magnetic field in the entire region within the coil. So this magnetic field B is equal to, once again, mu naught. This time we use N2 times I2, which is equal to mu naught, total number of turns over length of the solenoid, times I2. The flux through 1 is B dot A, and you can see that when we are finding the flux through the first coil, which is, we want a flux in this region, so we need to consider this area only and not the outer area, because this area is not going to contribute to the flux through the inner coil. So we get the magnetic field B is given by mu naught N2 I2 times the area A. This is the flux through one coil. So the flux through N1 turns of the inner coil will be N1 times this expression, which is mu naught N2 I2 A times the number of turns in the inner coil. Rearranging this, once again we can write this as N2 by L times N1 times I2 A. And mutual inductance is a ratio of phi 1 to I2. So M, now we are subscripting it as 1, 2, comes out to be mu naught N1 N2 over L times A. And you can see that this is the same value that we got earlier. So mutual inductance remains the same whether you take a current through 1 and flux through 2 or the current through 2 and flux through 1. Next, let's take a look at the SI unit of inductance. You know that mutual inductance M is equal to phi by I. Now, phi is measured in Webers and current in Amperes. So, 1 Henry is 1 Weber per Ampere. Now, the definition is also can also be given in a little different way. You know that the induced EMF is minus d phi by dt. So, here we can write phi as M times I, and M you know is a constant. So, this is di by dt. Now, if a current is changing at the rate of 1 ampere per second, so if this part is 1 ampere per second and this induces an EMF of 1 volt, then the circuit has an inductance of 1 Henry. Now, 1 Henry is actually an extremely large inductance. So, generally the values are in millihenries or microhenry. Let's now take a look at what is self-inductance. Consider a coil through which current is flowing. So, if current flows through the coil, you have a magnetic field all around the coil. Now, let's say that this current through the coil changes. So, if the current through the coil changes, the magnetic field through the coil changes and the flux linked with the coil also changes. Once again, we know from Faraday's law of electromagnetic induction that a changing flux leads to an induced EMF. And this EMF is a self-induced EMF. It is also called a back EMF. Now, the reason why we call it a back EMF is by Lenz's law, the induced EMF will oppose the change in current that produces it. This means it is making it difficult for the variation in current to occur. Now, next we'll define self-inductance. Self-inductance L is defined as phi over I. Here phi and I are in the same circuit. Now we'll find the self-inductance of this long coil. We have a solenoid over here of N turns and length L. The magnetic field inside the solenoid is given by mu naught N times I. N is the number of turns per unit length. The flux phi linked with each coil is given by B times the area of the coil. So this becomes mu naught. This is the flux through one turn of the coil. So the flux through the entire coil will be N times this. So the total flux will be N times. So you get mu naught and we have N square. So the self-inductance L, which is phi by I, is equal to mu naught N square A by L. And once again you can see this depends on the geometry of the coil and not on the current. So this is the self-inductance of a solenoid. To test your understanding, try this question. I've given you a small hint over here that the magnetic field at the center of a current carrying coil is given by mu naught I by 2R. So you need to take the current in one coil and find the magnetic flux to the other, and take the ratio of phi 2 to I 1 to find the mutual inductance between the two coils. The answer to this question is, if you've got this answer right, you've definitely understood how to find the mutual inductance for a given pair of circuits. If you haven't, don't bother. Go back, go through the lesson once again, and then try this question.